Gutes Neues. Ja. Evet. Evet. Seni sağlar. Okay. Okay, now we can start. Yeah. Hello everyone. I am Edi Tribaskoro. Good afternoon and welcome again to our combinatoric today series. First of all, I would like to extend our gratitude to the Dean of the Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Sciences, ITB, Professor Wahyu Sri Gutomo, for the constant support for this event. And also, I would like to welcome all colleagues and friends and students who are loyal in attending this program. We are really, really happy to have you in this program. Now, let us to have a big welcome to our speaker today, Professor Akihiro Munemasa, one of the world prominent combinatorists from Tohoku University, Japan. And we are very happy that he has been visiting Bandung several times. Hello, Professor Munemasa.
Hello, thank you for the
How are you
invitation.
today?
Very good.
Great. Okay, so thank you very much for accepting our invitation.
You're welcome.
Okay, and we would like also to mention that this program is brought by the Combinatorial Mathematics Research Group, Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Sciences, Institute of Technology, Bandung, with collaboration with the Center of Collaborative Research on Graph Theory and Combinatorics, Indonesia. Overall, this year, we have all 14 editions for this series, and today is the ninth edition. And the speakers are all outstanding combinatorists from various countries. And now we are all very excited and honored to have Professor Akihiro Munemasa from Tohoku University, Japan. And he will deliver a lecture with title Spare Packings, Road Systems, and Sine Graphs. And it will be chaired by Dr. Joko Suprianto. Okay, but before we give the control to Dr. Joko, let us have a group photo first. So in that case, I would like to ask Dr. Adit to help us to have a group photo.
Okay. Can you hear my voice?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's start maybe. So please turn on your video. Maybe I will wait for a few seconds. Right. I will count from five, starting now. So five, four, three, two, one.
Okay.
Okay. Again, maybe three,
Next
two, one. All right. Thank you, everyone.
Okay, thank you, Adit. And now I ask Joko to chair this session. Pak Joko. Belum terdengar, Pak Joko.
Oh, can't hear you. There was a problem with my earphone.
Ah, yes. Now
Okay,
it's okay.
good afternoon, everybody. Let me first introduce
Good afternoon.
Professor Akihiro Munemasa very shortly. But I want to share a screen. Can you allow me to share it? Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So, I will mention you a very short curriculum vitae of Professor Munemasa. So Professor Munemasa obtained his PhD degree in mathematics from The Ohio State University in 1989 under the supervision of Professor A.E.G. Banai. After finishing his master and bachelor program, both in Sophia University, in Tokyo, Japan. Yeah. And this is about his research and scholarly experience. After becoming having become a teaching assistant in Ohio State University around 1980, he first became an instructor in the Osaka Kyoiku University, and then become associate professor until 2003 in Kyushu University. And from April 2003, Professor Munemasa became a full professor in Tohoku University. And he also becomes involved in many several journals as an editorial board. First, since 1999 up to now, he is an editor in the Graph and Combinatorics. And from 2000 until 2017, he is an editor-in-chief of Journal of Algebraic Combinatorics. And from 2018 up to now, he is also an editor-in-chief of Algebraic Combinatorics. Just for your information, the first two journals as how should I say, a high standard journal, and it is very good if we can submit an appropriate article to both of that journal. And now, Professor Munemasa has also wide research areas of interest. And among them, including association schemes, and also distant regular graphs, and also combinatorial and spherical designs, and their generalization, including the spherical design in another compact symmetric space. And beside the three research areas, Professor Munemasa has also worked in some aspects in coding theory, and also he has some record in algebraic graph theory, and very recently he also works on some complex Adamant matrices. And for today, as we have known, he will talk about something related with some of these aspect of research areas, namely sphere packings, and also some aspect of algebraic graph theory and some geometry. And without further delay, I will invite Professor Munemasa to give a talk. So please, Professor Munemasa, time is yours.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you very much for a very kind introduction. Yeah, now let me start my talk by sharing the screen first. Okay, can you see my screen,
yes,
the first page?
Yeah.
Yeah, I hope I didn't make any mistake. So the title is Spheric Packings, Root System and Sign Graphs. Okay, so I start with a classical topic, which is somewhat beyond my beyond the scope of my research, but I guess some people might be interested in how wide the combinatorics is. And then eventually I will also mention graph theory at the end. So what is sphere packing? So there are two geometric problems in the Euclidean space. So from this picture, I guess you can see what I'm trying to describe. So the first problem is known as the kissing number problem. That's for the unit sphere S. Well, although I can only draw in the plane, but I consider mainly the space of dimension 3 or higher. So consider a unit sphere in the Euclidean space, and the center is the origin. So fix just one sphere and place as many as possible non-overlapping unit sphere around this. So I have one sphere centered at the origin, and it's clear that you can arrange six unit sphere around the unit sphere of the origin, and that's the maximum one, because there's no room to place seventh one. And so in general, the kissing number asks the same problem for higher dimension, and then it's not easy to imagine what the solution would be. And in fact, it is difficult to determine the exact solution. Even more difficult problem is known as sphere packing problem. So this is in the Euclidean space. Place non-overlapping equal radius sphere as dense as possible. So in the kissing number problem, it is in some sense, it is a finite problem, although the sometimes degree of freedom is infinity. But in this second problem, it's really an analytic problem, because you have a non-compact space, the real Euclidean space. So for the first problem, from the picture, it is clear what the solution is for the plane, but the n equals three. In the three-dimensional case, you can imagine the dodecahedron or icosahedron. You can put 12 unit sphere around a single unit sphere, and that is the maximum. But it was not trivial. It is quite hard to show that that is indeed maximum. And that was due to Schutt and van der Werdenen. And for higher dimensional case, the problem is quickly becomes more difficult, except the two exceptional dimensions, 8 and 24. These two instances, the problem has been solved earlier than the four-dimensional case. Banai and Sloan determined that solution to the kissing number problem in the 8 and 24 dimension already in 1981. And dimension 4, it is relatively recent. It is just due to Musin that the maximum was in fact determined to be 24. So that's the current status of the first problem, and all other dimension, the answer is unknown. For the second problem, it is considerably more difficult than the The second problem asks sphere packing in the Euclidean space, and it's more difficult than just placing finitely many spheres around a fixed sphere. So in this case, it is already quite difficult in n equal three. In fact, it's n equal two. In the plane, it is already difficult, but in n equal three, it is known as a Kepler's conjecture, and the only solved relatively recent by Thomas Hales in 1998. And more impressive work was done very recently by Wiazowska and others in 2017. Just like in the first problem, the exceptional dimensions 8 and 24 were solved by Wiazowska and others. And it was worth noting that Wiazowska won a Fields Medal by this work. But today, I mainly focus the first problem and related problems known as equiangular line problem. But the spirit is similar, so it is a problem in Euclidean geometry. So let me first give an answer to Musin's work. So Musin determined that the kissing number problem, in fact, the upper, Musin determined the upper bound to be 24 in dimension 4. That is, if you have a three-dimensional sphere in the four-dimensional Euclidean space and try to place as many possible non-overlapping sphere around the fixed sphere, then you can place 24 of them, but not more. It is easy to achieve 24. The difficult part is that you cannot achieve any more than 24. So this configuration can be described very easily, because if you require two adjacent sphere to not to overlap, that is, you have to place the sphere in such a way that they are 60 degrees apart. So these X describes the center of the sphere around the origin, of course, not the sphere at the origin. In fact, that can be described by points on the unit sphere. If you make these points to be on the unit sphere, then you have to scale by square root of 2 to make them unit vector. So, but these vectors are at least 60 degrees apart. Well, you can compute the angle of formed by two vectors in this set. If you have two vectors 60 degrees apart, then it is clear that if you draw unit sphere around it with these two centers, then they don't overlap. So the kissing number problem is to place as many points on the unit sphere such that any two of them are at least 60 degrees apart. So it is completely a problem of finding appropriate set of finite many points on the sphere. Now the vectors in the set X are of length square root of 2. So they are 60 degrees apart if and only if their inner products are at most 1. Because after scaling, you divide inner product by 2, and 1 over 2 is precisely the cosine of 60 degrees. The cosine. Later, I will use arc cosine a lot. So, this is cosine 60 degrees is 1/2. Okay. But this set X, if you take two vectors, they have integer coordinates, so there aren't so many different values in the product. Certainly, they are at most 1, but certainly it could be zero or negative one, but essentially those are the only one, except that if you take the same vector, then the inner product is two. If you take an inner product of x and negative of x, then the inner product is minus two. So these five values are the only possible inner product among the vectors in this set. X consists of 24 vectors. So yeah, it's, maybe I should say why this is, you can choose. There are two possible, two ways to choose two coordinates, and you have plus minus. So you have two times two, that's 24. So these are the solution to the Kissing number. This X is a solution to the Kissing number problem that the upper bound is 24. So this, the value in the product 2, 1, 0, minus 1, 2 correspond to the angles where two means the two vectors x, y are the same because they have length square root of two. And these 1, 0, minus 1, minus 2 corresponds to these values or these angles. Well, it is quite obvious to generalize this configuration to higher dimension because you just take two coordinates out of n coordinates and allow arbitrary signs on two non-zero coordinates. So here's how. So X can be generalized to higher dimension. You take just two non-zero coordinate and place one or minus one there. So this also satisfies the requirement of the inner product. So that means it satisfies the requirement that these two vectors are at least 60 degrees apart. So it gives a solution to the Kissing number problem, although it may not be the largest solution. So it doesn't really solve what the proper Kissing number problem is, but it's possible to place a sphere, a non-overlapping sphere according to this set. So this configuration has a name. It is known as the root system of type Dn. So D, there are root system of type A, B, C, D, E, F, and so on. Here in this talk, I will only use type D and E only. So this finite set of vectors is known as the root system type Dn, and we already saw that the pairwise inner products have these five values depend and correspond the angles 0, 60, 90, 120, 180 degrees. And this gives an optimal solution in four dimensions, but for higher dimension, either unknown or it is in fact not optimal. In fact, for the first exceptional dimension, that is dimension 8, it is easy to see that this is not optimal because one can add at least one more vector. In fact, there are many more vectors to Dn, still keeping the 60 degree apart. Why? Because I can add this particular vector x where all coordinates are 1/2. So this is an 8-dimensional vector. And its length is square root of 2, because if you compute the length and you have 1/4 or 1/2 square 8 times, so that's 2. And likewise, these vectors, all those vectors in X also have length square root of 2. And it is not difficult to see that the inner product of vectors, this little x and vectors in capital X, they all have value in this range. In fact, the 2 and minus 2 nip certainly do not occur because they are linearly independent. So if you pick a vector in capital X and take a inner product with little x, then it is either 1 or minus 0 or minus 1. So certainly, even if you add this little x to capital X, still this condition that the two vectors are at least 60 degrees apart is satisfied. In fact, the angles are restricted to these values. That means adding this vector still keeps the same set of inner products. In fact, you could not only add this particular vector X, but many more vectors of similar nature. In fact, there are 128 such vectors could be added. And that's the construction of the root lattice E8. So the root system D8 is, as I described, that you just take 2 out of 8 coordinates and place plus minus 1 there. And so there are 112 such vectors because 8 choose 2 for the positions and 2 square for 2 possible plus minus signs. And you can add 128 more vectors of this form, not only just plus minus, not only just 1 over 2 repeated 8 times, but plus minus 1/2 repeated 8 times, but except that there is one condition, you can't allow arbitrary sequence of 8 signatures, but you only allow even number of minus or equal number of plus. So there are 2 to the power 7 possible such vectors, and so there are 128 vectors. And so the union of this X and this set of 128 vectors is known as the root system of type E8. So it contains 240 vectors. And this is known as the unique solution shown by Banai and Sloan in 81 to the Kissing number problems in 8 dimension. So let me briefly mention how they managed to prove that this is the unique solution to the Kissing number problem. It originates the work done by Odlizko and Sloan 2 years earlier. In fact, the bound is already known to be 240. So what had to be proved is that the uniqueness of this configuration. So there's a theory developed by Delsalt, Hotels, and Seidel in 77, known as the theory of spherical codes and designs. And this theory is so powerful that if you have a set of vectors of, if you have a set of 240 vectors of with 60 degrees, at least 60 degrees apart, then the possible degrees are in fact determined to be what we have seen already, 60, 90, 120, 180. So you can't have 61 or 70 or 80 degree occurring in this configuration. But then if you have a set of vectors with only these angle up here, then it is contained in a root system. So if you want to as many points as possible, then it is in fact a root system. A root system have been already classified much earlier by Lee theorist. And in 8 dimension, there are only 3, A and D and E, and E8 has the largest number of vectors. So that's the unique solution. So once the angles are completely determined, it turns out that root system E8 is the only solution to the kissing number problem in R8. So this theorem is not so difficult once the theory of spherical codes and design are developed, and if you admit the work by Odlinska and Sloan. But there is another exceptional dimension where Banai and Sloan determined the uniqueness of the kissing configuration. That is dimension 24. In this case, the number of vector is much larger. It is 196,560. And Banai and Sloan also show the uniqueness of this configuration. Again, the method is quite similar. Again, it is based on this theory of spherical codes and designs and by the work of Odlizko and Sloan. But there is a slight difference. The kissing number problem is in 24-dimensional. Again, we use the theory of spherical codes and designs, and Odlizko and Sloan show that now if you have this many points in 24-dimension, and they are at least 60 degrees apart, then the angles are in fact determined to be one of these possibilities. Well, I omit trivial zero, or I might as well omit 180 degree, but instead of just 60, 120, and 90, there are two more angles. In fact, essentially only one arc cosine of 1/4. So this isn't a nice angle expressible in terms of degree, but some. In terms of the value of the cosine, it is easy to describe as 1/4. So it is some angle between larger than 60, but smaller than 90. And the theory also says that it is a spherical 11 design, but in this talk, I will not mention or use the knowledge of spherical 11 design. So for only those of you who are familiar with spherical design, that you might remember this configuration. Now, because of this existence of arc cosine 1/4, it is no longer a root system anymore. Now, to clear the denominator, I would rather represent this configuration not on the unit sphere, but the vectors of length 2 or squared length 4, so that the inner products are 4, 2, 1, 0, and they are negatives, depending on the value of the cosine. So Banai and Sloan used this fact to show that this configuration had to be the set of shortest vector of the Leech lattice. I guess some of you may not be familiar with Leech lattice, and during this talk, I do not have enough time to describe the Leech lattice, so I only give you a characterization characterizing property of the Leech lattice. But before doing that, let me explain what I mean by a lattice. Unfortunately, the word lattice has more than one meaning in combinatorics. And this is not what it's usually meant in combinatorics. It is rather a concept in number theory, or also known as the geometry of numbers. So For me, a lattice is an abbreviation of an integral lattice. It is a discrete subgroup, say L, of the real Euclidean space, such that the inner products are all integers. So, for example, if you take just a subgroup consisting of vectors with integer coordinates, then that is a lattice. There are many other lattices. For example, if you take a finite subset of Rn and assume that for any pair xy of that finite subset, then the inner product are integers. Then if you make a Z linear span, or Z linear combination of such vectors, then still the inner products are integers. And if you make a Z linear span, then you get the subgroup, and it turns out it is a discrete subgroup. So in this way, you obtain an integral lattice. So there are many, many integral lattices. It is easy to create non-isomorphic ones by taking appropriate subset X of Euclidean space. Now, for example, we have seen finite subset with this property, that is, for example, the root system Dn, because Dn has vectors with all coordinate integers, so it is an integral lattice, and we have seen that the inner products are one of these five values, so their Z linear span is an integral lattice, and it turns out to be this set, the set of vectors with integer coordinates, such that the sum of its coordinate. Here I'm taking an inner product with all one vector. So this is the sum of all coordinates of X, and I require that that sum is even. So this is a discrete subgroup of Rn, and it is known as the root lattice of type Dn. I need one more concept in the lattice theory, the dual lattice. Dual lattice of L is defined in this manner. So dual lattice consists of vectors which has the property that it has integer inner product with every element in the original lattice L. It is clear that because we are assuming the lattice is integral, so in the product between vectors in L are integers, so the elements of L certainly satisfy this condition. So the dual lattice always contains the original lattice. In general, it is bigger. Sometimes it is not bigger, but that it is equal. Now I'm ready to state the characterizing property of the Leech lattice. Leech lattice is a lattice living in the 24-dimensional Euclidean space and characterized by these four properties. So first, every vector has inner product with itself even integer. And the dual lattice is same as the original Leech lattice lambda. So in general, dual lattice could be bigger, but for the Leech lattice, the dual lattice coincide with itself. And the minimum, well, here I mean I'm mixing the notation, but the inner product with itself is same, exactly same as this square of the norm. So these two are the same. And in the first condition, I require that to be even integer. In the third condition, I require that this value is at least 4 because the minimum is 4. In other words, I have to exclude that x non-zero because otherwise the minimum would be 0. So the meaning of the third condition is that this is not two. The first condition says that it is 0, 2, 4, 6, and so on, but two has to be excluded. And then the last condition is that it contains sufficiently many vectors. For example, it contains 24 linearly independent vectors so that it spans the 24 dimensional space over real numbers. So this is the characterizing property of the Leech lattice. And then it is known that the set of all vectors, in fact, it is the shortest vector because the minimum is 4. The set of all shortest vectors of the Leech lattice is this number, which is precisely the upper bound in the Kissing number problem. So what Banai and Sloan did was that this configuration is the only configuration which achieves this bound, subject to the condition that the two vectors, two distinct vectors, are at least 60 degrees apart. Now, at least 60 degrees apart are the same as saying that the cosines are at most 1/2. That is because we are now considering vectors of norm 4. So the 60 degree apart means that the distinct vectors have inner product in this range. Well, if you disregard negative of the original vector. So x and x is 4, and x minus x has inner product minus 4. So the important point is that since we are assuming this is an integral lattice, the inner products are integer, but we are not allowing 3. Well, in fact, this is automatic, but because if we have two vectors with inner product 3, then the difference has inner product 2. But difference is in lambda because it is a subgroup, but the 2 cannot be allowed because the minimum is 4. So this explains why this, the inner product 3 is excluded. Okay. So this is the Leech lattice, and what Banai and Sloan did essentially was that from this knowledge, in fact, the knowledge obtained by Odlyzko and Sloan, one can recover the Leech lattice. That is, one can recover the lattice satisfying these four characterizing property. Okay, so that's, let's see how much we, okay, I still have more time to go to the second part. Now, second part, I want to explain a similar but different problem in the Euclidean space, that is a problem of equiangular lines with this particular angle, arc cosine 1/3. So here a set of line in Rn through the origin is called equiangular if there's an angle theta such that any two distinct line in this set form angle theta. So theta is some angle, but here I have only two lines, but in general, there could be many lines, but on the plane, you cannot have more than three lines because if you draw third line, well, then any pair of lines form an angle 60 degree, but you cannot have fourth line to keep 60 degrees. So in some sense, this problem looks quite similar to the kissing number problem, but for higher dimensional case, it is quite different. So the purpose of the my talk is to establish some connection between these the problem of kissing number problem and this equiangular problem. Okay. But in this example, in the plane, the angle is 60 degrees, so it is not arc cosine 1/3, it is arc cosine 1/2. More interesting problem is that this, when the angle is arc cosine 1/3. I will explain why. So consider the case the cosine theta is 1/3. So suppose you have a equiangular lines with this angle. And instead of dealing with lines, let's consider a set of vectors. So you pick a vector for each line. Well, I don't take unit vector, but I deliberately take a vector of length square root of 3. Because then the inner product becomes integer, in fact, plus minus 1, because cosine is 1/3. And depending on the direction of the vector you choose from a line, it could be negative. So in this case, the set of inner products obtained of two vectors in this set X obtained from equiangular line is 3, 1, minus 1, 3. 3 occurs when X is equal to Y, and minus 3 occurs when X is equal to minus Y. And these two are really linearly independent lines. Now these values look a little different from the two examples we have seen before. Root system are represented by vectors of square norm 2, and the set of inner products are these. And then for the Leech lattice, represented by vectors of norm 4, and the value 3 for the inner products are missing. But here I have 3 as the length of the vector or norm of the vector. It turns out that this set and root systems are related. So I explain this in this picture. So suppose you have a set of vectors of consisting of norm 3, and the inner products of distinct vectors are 1, minus 1, and minus 3. Of course, minus 3 means the negative of the other vector. Then, of course, I mean the set X is a subset of a Euclidean space, but I embed this Euclidean space to a Euclidean space with one dimension larger by taking a unit vector orthogonal to the Rn, where X lives. So I add this unit vector to each of the vector in the set X. So here is a picture. So I'm adding this vector U to various vector X, Y, and so on in the vector X. They live in this Rn. So Rn is like a hyperplane, in fact, affine hyperplane in the n plus one dimensional space. But then if I compute the inner product of vectors in this new set, then it turns out that this is 4, 2, 0, minus 2, because I have to add 1 as the inner product of u, u, which is 1. But 4, 2, 0, minus 2 are all even numbers, so I could divide by 2, and then it becomes 2, 1, 0, minus 1. And that is precisely what I would get from the root system. So starting from this set X, which represent equiangular lines, then I can place it on a affine hyperplane in the one in a space with one dimension higher, then I get a root system in R n plus one. Now, this process can be reversed, that I could start from a root system and try to construct a set of equiangular lines. So start from a root system and make the vector longer by multiplying the length by square root of two, and then the vector in the root system could be projected onto a hyperplane, and then they form an equiangular line system with angle arc cosine 1/3. Yeah, more precisely speaking, let me just give an example. So let's take a root system of type D8. So it consists of vectors with two non-zero coordinate, where non-zero coordinate are plus minus one in dimension eight. And E8, the root system E8 was constructed by adding an extra vector of all 1/2. If I fix this vector Z and consider those vectors in this hyperplane, which is which has the property that it has inner product one with this vector Z, then I get equiangular line system. So let me call this a slice of the root system, because I somehow cut the root system by this hyperplane of dimension seven. So in this slice consists of not all the D8, but part of D8, and together with some other vector written in terms of linear combination of this particular Z and others. And this first part consists of all vectors with two non-zero coordinate, and where two non-zero coordinate are just one. This will ensure that the inner product with Z is one. So there are 8 choose two, 28 such vectors. You may say that this configuration could be is just a line graph or complete graph K8. Yeah, because this 8 choose 2 can be thought of the set of edges of the complete graph. So in some sense, this root system of type D, or maybe regarded as some part of type E, can be described by graph theoretic manner using the language of line graph. So here is what I found with my co-author, Meiyu Tsao, Jack Colin, and my former student, Kyoto Yoshino. And the statement is as follows. So a maximal set of equiangular lines in the Euclidean space with this angle, arc cosine 1/3, is completely classified, and it is represented by a line graph of various graph. Oops, sorry, I forgot to write K here. For dimension 5, 6, and 7, there are some exceptional configuration. What are the exceptional ones? Exceptional ones are these. Sorry, non-exceptional ones are this family. Sorry, this is L of k 2 comma n minus 1. So it is a generalization of these. So our result classifies maximal set of equiangular line with this angle arc cosine 1/3, and it turns out that they precisely correspond to slices of root system. Here I'm not quite precise when saying this represented. So let me explain a little bit more precisely. So here what I mean by represented by a graph is that you choose a set of vectors x for equiangular lines. So the lines are represented by a vector of length 3 and no duplicates, of course. And then its gram matrix has diagonal entry 3 because of this, and the off diagonal entries are inner product of two linearly independent vectors, so they are plus minus 1, and matrices with plus minus 1 in off diagonal can be expressed by a 0-1 matrix. In fact, the 0-1 matrix, symmetric matrix, is an adjacency matrix of the graph. So in this manner, the gram matrix can be expressed in terms of an adjacency matrix of the graph. So that's what exactly what I mean by represented by a graph. So this is how the description of the maximal set of equiangular lines. Now, there is only one set which is very special property among these maximal sets. Now, for the root system, I don't allow zero here, but if I have not a set of equiangular lines, but I have a set of lines with two angles, then the corresponding configuration are something similar to the Leech lattice case. So here is how the similar picture is shown, that if you have a equiangular line, then the inner products are this way. And if you place them on the hyperplane, then inner product becomes this because you add one. So that can be regarded as slice of a root system. Now, if you allow zero, that means if I allow zero here, I should have written this 3 instead of 2. If I allow zero, that means I allow two vectors be orthogonal in X. So for example, this vector Z and Y could be orthogonal. So it is not the equiangular line, but the line with two angles. One angle is arc cosine of 1/3, the other angle is the 90 degree. Suppose I have a configuration of this type. Then I have zero here, and if I add one, then it becomes one here. So just allowing 90 degree in the equiangular line set to make them two angle set of lines, then I get something which would appear in the Leech lattice. So if I start from a set of line with two angles, not only arc cosines 1/3, but also 90 degrees. Then we have this set of inner products, and by the trick of embedding it into hyperplane in Euclidean space of one dimension higher, I get this. So this is part of a configuration typically appearing in the Leech lattice. But there is no axiomatic treatment unlike root system. So that's why I wrote question mark here. It is still unknown how to treat systematically this kind of configuration. But I think this is very interesting and worth studying. So let me explain why. So a set of equiangular line in Rn equals strongly maximal if no more line can be added, even if the dimension is increased. So if I require a line to be equiangular, then obviously there's an upper bound. One cannot add any more lines in that space. But this strong maximality is something very, very restrictive, that if you increase the dimension, still you cannot add. It is difficult to believe that such a configuration exists, but it turns out that such a line exists. But let's see under what condition this occurs. So as before, take a equiangular line set with arc cosine 1/3. And if it is not strongly maximal, then one can add another line L, possibly increasing the dimension. But if you project the line L to the original n-dimensional space, but the line represent line L by vector of norm 3, and projecting it then it becomes a vector of length our norm at most 3. It could be shorter because after making projection. And adding new lines, so this vector will not be any of the vector representing the line L. So you have a set, there is a new vector Y of norm at most 3, which has the property that they still form a equiangular line, so plus minus one as inner product. In particular, it has integer inner product with all elements in X, so it is a element of the dual lattice spanned by this set. So here is the definition of the dual lattice. So if you know the knowledge, if you have some knowledge of the dual lattice, then sometimes you can show that non-existence of such a vector Y. And that is precisely the case where the root lattice of TE8. It is known that the root system type E8 generates a lattice whose dual is same as itself. And using this fact, we can show that this root lattice, the configuration of 28 lines in 7 dimensions coming from the slice of EA is strongly maximal. That is, no other line could be added even if you go to dimension 8. And it turns out that this is the only such set. That is, no other set of equiangular line in any dimension with angle arc cosine 1/3 is strongly maximal. So this characterize a very peculiar property of the root system type EA. And Leech lattice also has this property that the dual lattice is same as the original one. So analogous result could be obtained. And in fact, it is true that we could extend the definition of strong maximality not only to the equiangular line, but the set of line with 2 angles. And the definition read exactly the same. No more line can be added, even if the dimension is increased. But of course, I mean, you have to keep the angle to one of these. And then, if you take a slice of the leech, that is, for the slice of the root system, this was 2 and 1, but for the leech lattice, it is replaced by 4 and 2, and this configuration of lines has angle cosine 1/3 and 90 degrees, and it turns out that this is strongly maximal. This set of line contains 2,300 lines. So it is equally as peculiar as the root system type E8. So in some sense, the dimension 8 and 24 looks very exceptional in Euclidean geometry. Okay, so let me finish with the problem. So this occurred only in dimension 24. I don't know whether similar situation could occur in smaller dimension. I know it occurs in 25 dimension, that comes from the leech lattice. So the question is that, is there a set of lines in Rn, where n less than or equal to 23, with angle arc cosine 1/3 and arc cosine 0, which is strongly maximal in the sense that one cannot add any more lines L while keeping the mutual angle to be these two, even if the dimension is increased. So I'm asking how strange that the leech lattice example is in the sense of lines with two angles. I hope this answer will be true, but there may be some other interesting configuration in smaller dimension. So if you are interested in, please look into this problem. So this is a problem, I should mention that this is a problem in the sine graph with small eigenvalue -3, because the lines with two angles could be represented by vectors of norm 3, and then they could be conveniently described by switching class of a signed graph. Because the inner product 0 corresponds to non-edge, the inner product 1 or -1 correspond to plus edge or minus edge. So in fact, this is really a problem in signed graph theory. So, for those of you who wants to study this subject, the principal reference is this very thick book written by Conway and Sloan. In fact, it is not written by Conway and Sloan alone. It consists of very chapters who have individual authors. So for example, the paper by Odlizko Sloan and Banai Sloan are contained in chapter 13, 14 of this collection of articles. Okay, that's all I want to say. So thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Sensei.
You're welcome.
Yeah, very. We just followed the lecture from Professor Morimasa. He talked about several different, seems to be different object, and he give us a connections to each other. And I think before we are entering the second session about discussion session, it seems that Paedi will give us some art performance video. So please, Paedi.
Okay. So I will present some performance. This is an angklung performance. You know, I think everybody here knows about the angklung performance, angklung instruments, yeah, made from bamboo. I think Professor Akihiro Munemasa has played angklung instrument.
I enjoy that performance very much.
Okay, now let's me to play the song. This moment, yeah. Okay, let me. What is it? Ah, you are. So the title of the song is Radobi, played by ITB student.
We are thousands from coming, we have traveled land and sea, but as long as you are with me, there's no things I'd rather be.
Okay. Okay. That's all the performance.
Okay.
Now back to Pak Joko.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Pak Edi. So now we are entering the discussion session, and I know that we have among the participants, we have several friends from Philippines. There are Professor Balmaceda and also Jumela Sarmiento, and also I think Rowena and also Camara. So I invite you first to give a comment to Professor Manimasa's talk, or comment or a question, please. Do you have any? Okay.
Joy.
Thank you. Hello, Akihiro. Good to see you.
Hello.
Thank you very much for your talk. I think the topic is very interesting and connects to many areas done by both algebraic combinatorialists and other people. I don't have any question, but how about this? I know for if you have a fix or for each fixed angle, and maybe perhaps in all large enough dimensions, is the maximum number of equiangular lines known? I don't know that. For each angle, your given angle.
Yeah. Yes. So for most angles, the bound is rather boring, but for the arc cosine 1/odd integer, like arc cosine of 1/3, 1/5, and 1/7, and so on, the bound could be large.
Okay.
So if the dimension is large, then you also need to make this denominator large. But I think it was recently established by Yufei Zhao, the general result that bounds in this particular case.
Okay. I see. Thank you very much. Also, just a second question. Your definition of maximal and special, does that refer only to those two given angles that you gave?
Yes, yes. Yeah, I fix angle, and I only discuss maximality and stronger maximality with respect to that angle. Of course, you could generalize to any other fixed angle.
Okay, thanks, and good to see you again. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for asking me question.
Okay, thank you, Joy. Any other questions, please? Yes, Afif, please.
Thank you for the talk. And I think I had some question, and it's better if I type the question. Wait a minute.
Yes. Can you read, Sensei?
Yes. On the sphere packing problem, why do we only consider the case Rn when 2, 3, 4, 8, 24? We hope to consider all dimensions, but the other dimensions are difficult. We don't know the answer. That's the answer to the first question. And then second question, by extending the dimension in the strongly maximal domain, does it mean that adding zero to the end of the entry is a given root system? Well, you may think of that way, because we just add orthogonal complement and one dimensional space. So it is same as adding the zero coordinate to the existing configuration. And third question, what are the methods used in your paper to prove the uniqueness of the system? Well, the uniqueness, uniqueness of the maximality, but they actually follow from classification of root system. So I don't work very hard to obtain these results once I establish connection to the root systems.
Is it enough, Api?
Is it enough?
Okay, okay. I think I mean just for the third question, I think. So how do we know that what tools do we use to classify all the root system possible?
So you want to know how root system could be classified?
Yeah, yeah, like that.
Yeah, yeah. This is very well known topic. Appearing in various different parts of mathematics. So this is also known as the classification of Coxeter group. Those are the groups generated by involutions, or also the classification of groups generated by reflections. So you have a set of vectors forming a particular angle, 60 degrees and 90 degrees. And then eventually, these are machinery called Dynkin diagram. So if you start with a root system, it is possible to create a Dynkin diagram, and then then you just invoke the classification of graphs with spectral radius 2. There are very few of them. And that actually gives the classification of root system type A, D, and E.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you very much for the answers.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions?
Rowena wrote me a direct question.
Oh.
Yeah. Maybe some people, my terminology wasn't clear, because the word norm usually means the generalization of length. So if I say the inner product with itself is 2, right, then actually the length of the vector is square root of 2, not 2. Yeah, but usually it is quite common in the theory of integral lattices that the squared norm is just called norm.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, because we don't like irrational numbers.
Uh-huh.
So we want to stay in the integers. So we don't usually take square root of the inner product with itself and just call it norm.
Okay.
So root system consists of vectors on norm 2, and equiangular line with arc cosine 1/3 are represented by vectors of norm 3. And for the Leech lattice, the shortest vectors have norm 4. Okay.
Okay. Any other comment or questions, please? Okay, by the way, Sensei, I have a very small question, I think. So far, if someone talk about the solution of kissing number in 8 and 24 dimension, then they mention three names, Levenstein in one side and Odlyzko and Sloan in another themes in their works published in 1979. But you mentioned in your first slide, I think, that this problem is solved by Banai and Sloan in 2 years later.
Yeah, yeah.
My question, what is the main difference between the work of Banai Sloan in 1981 and Levenstein and Odlyzko Sloan 2 years earlier regarding the kissing number in 8 and 24 dimensions?
Yeah, Odlyzko Sloan, I think, only determined the upper bound.
Oh, and okay.
What happened when the upper bound occurs, then the set of inner products is very restricted.
Oh, okay.
Still, they didn't characterize Leech lattice.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
although
okay.
the for the dimension 8, then the result is almost automatic. So you might say that all these guys already solved dimension 8, but the dimension 24, somehow you have to use a characterization of the Leech lattice.
Okay. Thank you, Sensei.
You're welcome.
Any other questions or comments? Paedi, maybe?
Actually, there is no question from me, but I just surprised that there is a connection. The one that you mentioned, Professor Munemase, in the characterization of the equilateral lines, yeah, the maximal size.
Equiangular lines.
With the line diagram. So this is,
line graph.
How do you how do you find this? The connection for this one.
Yeah, the line graphs are precisely. Line graphs are precisely not quite, but almost the graphs represented by the root system of type A. This was known already by Cameron and others in the 70s.
Okay. Right.
Okay. Sorry, Sensei. Maybe this is very, how should I say? Not very good question, but I really want to know about it. When you say that the certain equiangular line can be characterized by certain line graph, what you mean by characterize is you consider the form of the Gram matrices.
Yes. So graph determines adjacency matrix, and adjacency matrix can be converted to a Gram matrix with diagonal 3.
So is it possible if we consider, let's say, another matrices different with a Gram matrices, then we may obtain that the form of that new matrices can be equal to some certain all one matrices plus identity and plus certain adjacency matrix, and adjacency matrix of some graph, and then is it possible for us to obtain another graph different with line graph if we not consider Gram matrices, another matrix instead of Gram matrices, for characterize the equiangular lines?
I'm not sure if it makes sense to consider matrices other than Gram matrices, because the configuration in the Euclidean space, finite set vectors, are essentially equivalent object as Gram matrices, or that is positive semi-definite symmetric matrices.
Okay. Thank you, Sensei. So it's the time is up, I think. So I go back to Paedi. So please, Paedi.
Okay. So thanks again to Professor Munemase for very interesting,
thank you.
Inspiring
thank
talk. So
yeah, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity.
Before we close the session, let me present some certificate to Professor Munemase. Okay, just a moment. Okay, so this is on behalf of the combinatoric mathematics research group and also the center of the graph theory and combinatorics, we would like to thanks to Professor Munemase for giving us lectures today. So this is the certificate that we are going to send you, this certificate. And also one more thing. Sorry. Let me, this is another one. this is our deeply thanks to Professor Munemase for these lectures. Okay, so this is done by our students, actually. Of course, make these pictures according to your photo, and they use AI program to do that.
Oh.
Okay, I hope you enjoy for these two documents. Okay, so I will send you these two documents to Professor.
Yeah, Bob. Thank you. I ask my son to see how.
Okay, so thanks again to everybody here for joining this program, Professor Joey. Thank you, Professor Jumela, and Professor Obata just recently left. And to all of them, all of you, thank you very much for being here. And see you next 2 weeks. Next 2 weeks will be another program for this program.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, see you, Sengen.
Sensei, by the way, could you share your slide, Sensei, to us?
I don't know. I corrected during my lecture. So I don't know which one. And also the original tech file doesn't contain pictures. So let's see. Anyway, I will send.
Just send it to me, and then we will distribute to our. Okay. Thanks.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Okay. But Joey, how are you today?
How are you?